I'll find that shallow point, and I'll find all the drops, and hopefully I'll have a nice little walleye spot, maybe smallmouth too. I see this jig going up and down. All of a sudden it says, hey, let's wake up. There's one. That is cool. You expect all weather conditions. It doesn't stop me from coming out of fishing. Look at that fish. That is awesome.
The Fish in Canada Show, brought to you in part by Ram Trucks, built to serve. Prince Craft Boats, dominate the waters. Garmin Panoptics, all-seeing sonar. Mercury Outboards, go boldly. And Outdoor Canada, Canada's only national fishing and hunting magazine. Yes, we're in for some good fishing, Canada.
I'd like to look at today's Fishing Canada episode as learning how to fish a new lake. Not just for you, the audience, for me as well. I'm at Chapleau Lodge on Borden Lake within the Arctic watershed in the Algoma region of Ontario.
This is Chapleau Lodge on Borden Lake. It's about a 12-mile long lake. We've got depths up to 160 feet of water here with several different varieties of fish here. We're the only lodge on this whole lake, so it's a very strong fishery. There's not a lot of pressure here.
There's walleye, pike, and smallmouth bass in the lake. I'm going to concentrate primarily on the walleye. However, I have been known to stray away. I think that's human nature to an angler. For my first shot at this new body of water, I'm going to try a suggested spot by Bob, one of the longtime lodge clients. He says the area is full of depth changes, none of which are charted on any bathymetric maps. Sounds interesting.
And he said, yeah, there's a little hump out there that's not shown on the map. And he runs Garmin equipment too. So I will find the edges of this thing. I'll turn on the quick draw feature of this thing. And now what it'll end up being, it'll be a hump out in the middle of the lake that's not showing up. And that could be a prime structure. 19 feet of water right now. Bob says it comes up to about 5 or 6. I'll find that shallow point and I'll find all the drops and hopefully I'll have a nice little walleye spot, maybe smallmouth too. So without, first off, a depth finder slash fish finder, you'd never know to stop here. All of a sudden you're running in 35, 40 feet of water and whoosh, it comes up. It's like, whoa, what is that? And you slow down and then you can run on the clear view. There's 10, look at that, 9 feet of water, 7 feet of water. Here's the peak of it right here. I'm gonna mark a waypoint just to mark that. And now I can go from there. That's 6 feet of water.
After a series of passes using the quick draw feature, which the folks at Garmin call mowing the grass, my units quickly revealed an unbelievable piece of structure that looks like it's handmade for walleye. In this series of screenshots, you'll see how I brought tons of detail into a featureless chart. Screenshot 1 is the area with my waypoints and no bathymetric mapping. Screenshot 2 has the basic mapping of the area. Screenshot 3 has my completed map of quick draw contours. Lots of detail, but hard to read, right? In screenshot 4, I've added in some color to my contours in 5-foot increments. These different colors give me a really good idea as to what the structure actually looks like. As you can see in screenshot 5, all but one of my waypoints, mostly marking fish that I saw with my traditional fish finding screen, were on the tip or deep end of that hump. That says a lot. Starting with an undetailed, slow-dropping break, I quickly turned my newly mapped fishing area into an intricate hump with many nuances.
Look at all this different stuff here. It's crazy. You'd never know that without drawing those features out.
This is modern-day technology that we as anglers can and should use on pretty much every outing.
What we got? There, it's a walleye. Can I sling him in? Yeah, just sling him in. There you go. Yeah. Quick draw. First basically drop. I dropped an ice fishing jig down. And what happened there was that I went back to my waypoint. Fish move a lot, especially walleye. They move a ton, right? So So now you're going back towards that waypoint where I marked the fish. And in the process, I'm not seeing anything along the bottom, nothing along the bottom. Right here where I locked on, all of a sudden you're seeing fish here now, right? So one of two things happened. Either you came upon the pot of fish you saw, or it's a bigger group of fish. And by using a lure like this ice fishing jig, you actually draw fish into the area, either from out farther, they see it moving around, or when they're stuck right to the bottom, they're glued right to the bottom where you can hardly read them. It looks like almost like a rock on there. All of a sudden they start rising up. They see this jig going up and down. All of a sudden they says, hey, let's wake up. That guy hit like a ton of bricks. It's pretty neat watching your electronics, using them, especially vertical fishing. It's so much fun, because all of a sudden it becomes a video game almost, right? You're sitting there and you're seeing nothing, and all of a sudden, wait a minute, there's some hooks that are moving up off the bottom. And it's just, they appear out of nowhere almost, and it's so cool. And then when you hook up like I just did there, boy, I'll tell you, it can be deadly. That just felt like a bump going on the way down too. And you don't have to go with the super expensive units. All the Garmin fish finder units do exactly what this does right here. Show you fish, show you bottom, GPS, you know, if you have GPS combo, but just the fish finder alone, all you need is a basic unit and you can start watching the structure and better yet, watching the fish. Best part of smallmouth bass, no matter how big or small they are, they're tough, tough as nails. That is cool.
Of all the fishing lodges that Ange and I have traveled to, Chapleau might just be the most unique. There's more than fishing here.
In the fall season, we also offer a commercial diving training course here at Chapleau Lodge. It's called Canadian Working Divers Institute. We're an internationally recognized course. We go through intensive training for underwater welding, inspection, blasting, concrete forming, any of the jobs you might find in the commercial industry. As we move through the course, we'll move out into deeper and deeper water. We'll end up into 165 feet of water out here in Borden Lake. Here, the guys will dive deep and they'll be licensed to run decompression chambers with all different styles of diving. It's a very intense course, but our guys come out trained and ready for industry.
Borden Lake is not just a walleye lake. It harbors a really nice population of smallmouth bass as well. Oftentimes, during the midday lulls of walleye fishing, or muskie, or pike, I'll switch gear for a change in pace. Can't tell. I don't think he's big, but he's not bad. Is anybody with him yet? There's another one with him, too. Of course, the one with him is bigger. And he's biting him. He bit at him. Wow, that was so cool. That second fish down there is a half a pound bigger, which is not that much of a fish, but it was cool. He bit right at this fish. Like, I mean, bit him. Trying to get that bait. Look at that. See the crayfish parts? He just kicked out of some. Look down right there on my rod tip. Look, there's the other fish. He just grabbed it. That other fish just grabbed the crayfish part. That is cool. His buddy, this guy spit out crayfish. The lake is full of crayfish. He spit one out, and his buddy hanging around. Finally, this is what they do. They fight so hard that they puke it out, and his buddy went and grabbed the claw. It was awesome. That little guy hung on with him, and then finally he puked out something, and he got it. That was so cool. He ate it. Free meal. Little fighter, little scrapper. Best part of smallmouth bass, no matter how big or small they are, they're tough, tough as nails. He's trying to go back into the log where I caught him. I caught him right off those logs there. Oh, look at the crayfish parts. Look at this, all that stuff. Look at, he's spitting them out like crazy. Look at the mess of stuff he's got in the water there. How awesome is that? So he was just spitting out crayfish, and then he still ate that little Ned rig. Little crazy looking little thing, not much. It's got, you know, I use that color because it's a great all-around color, but it's, especially with crayfish. Look at the belly in that guy. That thing is full of crayfish. Imagine getting a 4-pounder, it'll be just loaded. It'll be like a 3-pound body with a pound of crawfish meat in it. Stuff like that. Nice. Not bad at all. I saw him on the screen too. This is fun. This is video game fishing.
want.
Easy. Wow, runner. Well, you know what? With this light line, I'm gonna net him. That's why you bring a net along, just in case. You get one that will just big enough to break your line. Actually, he's not bad. He's not bad at all. I'm surprised at that fish. Chunky guy. Chunky. Little, it's called a Ned rig. It's just a little do-nothing, very ultralight rig on light 6-8 pound test line. A fat little fish. Nice. There's a little tree off the shoreline that comes out, a little branch of a tree, and I cast to it, and it, the fish might have come off the tree or was out a little deeper, but beautiful. I'll take that guy. That's fun. Middle of the day stuff. Hey, yeah, little buddy. Nice.
With low evening light setting in, I have to return to my newly mapped walleye structure I created earlier in the day. I'm now familiar with it, and I know there are walleye in the area.
I saw a school of these guys on the Garmin, but they look, because they're not very deep, they look a lot bigger. And I stopped right over top of them, and I started pop, and I could feel the pop. I bet you there's 5 or 6 of them down there that size. I just wanted to verify the size of them. Now I can move on. I don't need any more of you guys. Yeah, you just sit right over top of them with any kind of jig, vertical jig. And you see them on your finder, and you try and catch them. Have some fun with it. Get some kids around. If you get kids in the boat, that's the perfect fish right there. Teach them how to jig a little bit. Teach them how to stay on a fish, watch the fish finder, and do their little video games out here in the boat. There's one. And I saw him on the screen too. This is fun. This is video game fishing. another walleye. Another perfect eater shore lunch walleye. Look at that. That is a fine tasting specimen of Ontario walleye right there, folks. He's not a giant, but I'll tell you what, you can have some fun with these guys. Look at that. Beautiful little fish. Here we go, little boy. Little boy, little girl. Nice. I saw one fish, and I got him. What I'm doing is I'm looking at the fish finder screen, the traditional screen. Sometimes I don't even have the clear view on there. And then when you see a hook, or what looks like a fish, or looks like a hook, you turn the clear view on, and that tells you everything. What happens is if it's not a fish, it's a blob, it's a rock. You can see the whole structure, even though it looks like a hook. When it's a fish on that clear view, it's a little dot or separation, and it's such a difference.
Time to put the sticks away, head back to the camp, and grab a late supper. I've still got one more day of great walleye fishing.
Obviously, you see a little rainstorm falling in here. It doesn't stop me from coming out fishing. Look at the fish down there. Look at those hooks. Whoa.
To get to today's fishing on Borden Lake, I first drove north on Highway 400. I continued north on 69 and then headed northwest on Highway 17 at Sudbury. I next turned right on 129 and finally turned onto Devon and Allen Side Road, taking me directly to Chapleau Lodge. This great facility is not only a fine fishing resort, but is home to one of Canada's top-rated commercial diving schools. Come here to either learn, fish, or relax, or do it all on the same trip. Yesterday's great walleye day ended in a gorgeous sunset. On this morning, though, the forecast is rain. Luckily, I've got a great lay of the land from yesterday's electronic mapping session, so now all I have to do is figure out the same fish in different conditions.
There's one. Jigging fish, down a little deeper. Actually feels all right. Feels like a walleye. What do we got? Again, on the ice fishing jig, there he is. Nice walleye. Look at that. It's a decent walleye. No, I'm gonna net that guy. I don't wanna break my string. Let's see.
Nice. You know what? He'll do. When the fishing is a little bit tough, weather conditions, this weather just moved in on us and just got a little bit crazy. Perfect walleye. Perfect Northern Ontario walleye right there. We're looking for bigger, but you're gonna keep a shore lunch. That guy would be the one over probably, and then you just keep some smaller than that. Get beautiful fillets off of him. Best meat in the world. See you, partner. Gone. This is a point of reef. There's just, I mean, rocks are the key in Northern Ontario. You don't find a whole lot of weed beds as compared to anything else. You know, if there's any wood around, there might be some walleye, but rocks are the biggest thing. Shoals, rocks, anything like that. So he's going to find the best shoal you can. Look for fish, look for hooks on your fish finders. There's a bunch of activity down there right there like that. That's probably small fish, but, or look for bait. If you find bait or hooks of fish, you've got it all right there. You know, then you stick on it, you mark it with your GPS, and then just work it back and forth like this. So I'll work this for a little bit longer, and if the weather allows me to stay out a bit longer, I'll try and get a big one.
Although I'm not a fan of getting soaked, I am a fan of fishing in the rain. Let's be honest, the conditions are pretty much perfect. You have overcast cloudy skies cutting light penetration, raindrops on the surface creating a barrier or shield to help camouflage the angler, and what may be the most significant, a change in weather. Weather changes are often a key factor in turning on fish feeding cycles. On this day, all of those elements moved their way in and put me back in walleye mode. It was perfect.
Look at the fish down there. Look at those hooks. Whoa. Ooh, this one's pulling. Obviously, you see a little rainstorm pulling in here. I put the hood on, put the rain gear on, get myself all set up. I mean, you gotta expect it. You're in Northern Ontario. You gotta expect all the worst of the weather. This fish feels all right. And it feels like a walleye. And what I'm doing, I'm dragging a bottom bouncer. And I got a slow death hook on. Ooh, I like that. Slow death hook on, but I'm not doing the slow death technique. Slow death technique for walleye is just taking a half a worm, hooking it and letting it spin and spin and spin. What I did was I got lazy and I took a full night crawler and I nose hooked them like I would Lindy riggings or just bottom bouncing. There's the bottom bouncer there. Oh, good walleye. Look at this guy. Oh yeah. This is a good walleye. Now he came up from under the deep. Oh. That makes fishing in the rain worth it. I'll tell you, look at that fish. I don't mind fishing in the rain. Usually you don't see us shooting in the rain too often because it's very hard to handle a camera in the rain. But look at that, just barely hooked. So he took a full, there's that little slow death hook, weird shape to it. It spins around and around and around like that with a little worm. It's a weird technique, but I kind of just got lazy. My lazy slow death. Nice fish. Good looking walleye. That is awesome. That makes the trip so worthwhile. Look at that. What a good looking walleye. Nice dark one. That one come down. That you can tell when they come from the deeper. I think they're a little darker. Good looking fish. Okay. You deserve to go home. I'm gonna put him back. Her back. It back. Because it bit on my crazy technique. My slower than slow death. There you go, in the rain. Look, you got a little water on your lens there. It doesn't stop me from coming out fishing, I'll tell you what. Sometimes just off the camera coming out, but a typical in Northern Ontario, anywhere in the Northern Canada, when you're coming to a lodge, you expect all weather conditions. I got long johns, I got toques, I got gloves. Of course, they're all back at the camp right now. That was awesome.
Today's Garmin hotspot is what I refer to as What About Bob, because my Chapleau Lodge next door neighbor Bob put me on it. The uniqueness to this hotspot is that it's a gorgeous piece of structure that doesn't show up on any charts. By making a number of intersecting passes using Quick Draw, I put together a perfect layout of the area. Essentially, this hotspot is a big extension of a land point that eventually plummets into deep water, perfect for walleye. I used ice fishing jigs as well as regular jigs with either a cast and lift retrieve or jigging them directly under the boat. For more hotspots like this one, check out fishingcanada.com.
The Fish in Canada Show, brought to you in part by Ram Trucks, built to serve. Prince Craft Boats, dominate the waters. Garmin Panoptics, all-seeing sonar. Mercury Outboards, go boldly. And Outdoor Canada, Canada's only national fishing and hunting magazine.
Closed captioning for this episode was brought to you by fishingcanada.com, the gateway to your next fishing adventure.